Hey everybody, my name is Robert Stevens. I'm from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. It's my great pleasure to open this session, this aligned SOCCA AUA IARS session, which is devoted to the topic of precision medicine. The title is Towards Precision Medicine in the Intensive Care Unit. I think there's a little typo on the program. We have an absolutely spectacular panel of speakers today. Each of them is going to be talking for about 20 minutes, and then there will be about 2 to 3 minutes after each talk for questions from you guys. So we welcome, of course, all of your input. The first speaker today is Dr. Vitaly Herasevich. He's from the Mayo Clinic Rochester, and the title of his talk is Clinical Informatics for Predictive and Prognostic Modeling in the ICU. Vitaly.
Thanks. Good morning. In the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to tell you a little bit about modeling, but yeah, from perspective of the artificial intelligence and all this buzzword what you have, but I will not tell how good it is. I actually leave you with more questions than answers and show you realistic pictures what actually going on. Okay, that's probably a question what everybody want to have answer. Will the artificial intelligence replace me? Short answer is no. Not yet. What is the problem? Yeah, in ICU we have deal with 200 variables during critical care rounds, and there are very well known fact what systematic response, more than 7 variables at the time, impossible. During the night, probably it's only 2 variables. And people who say they are multitaskers, they are genius or liars. You know, if you have somebody who say this, just hire them. And what all this lead, brain overflow, people get distracted and having ability to make right decision. But really, if we have to see these 2 sets of the tools, we clearly can identify on the left something to fly, on the right something to drive. There are 2 different environments, but we still have EMR what get very the same data for every environment. And we all know current EMR incapable identify information what clinicians consider useful for decision making. All this bad for patients. Failure to recognize, failure to rescue, waste, and communication breakdown. And solution would be what called patient-centered ambient intelligence. I mean, we talk about prediction models, we talk about this decision support system, but think about this. Yeah, we have tool set which give decision analytics. It's informed decision. And I mean, CAR is a great example. I mean, dashboard in the front of you, it's a decision analytics. Yeah, it give you speed and other information to make decision. There's some kind of the GPS in a car which give you predictive analytics, possible future, where are you going and what is happening. And simple mirror, descriptive analytics, it's a past data because you already passed it, but it still give you idea in a past. There are like 3 steps decision system. And now we are talking about brave new world. IBM Watson, 2011, there are a lot, 8 years ago, by the way, okay? IBM Watson deliver into medicine. IBM Watson will be physician assistant very soon. 2013, MD Anderson power man shot with artificial intelligence. And in 2016, there interesting report was issued after spending over $60 million on the planning, the oncology expert advisory system did not connect to clinical EMR at MD Anderson and wasn't in a use at that time. The same time, 2016, there are cooking with Chief Watson, IBM's artificial intelligence up. And don't get wrong, IBM Watson is pretty good, and they do well in security world, in financial world, and so. But yeah, the attempt to get into medicine was not very successful. And yeah, 2018, a lot of publication in major media happened. $15 billion spent on the Watson in healthcare, and still very, very limited usage of that. They charge money to use it, and the prediction power, it's not great. It's really clinicians who try to use it, they say, I cannot trust it fully. Interestingly, artificial intelligence in medicine, it's not something new. It's not 2018, 2011. It's something what in use like decades and decades back. See, there's a book from 1982, which says artificial intelligence in progress for past 15 years, okay? This is healthcare informatics, 1995, and one of the titles, using artificial intelligence to predict myocardial infarction. It's, again, 25 years ago. Artificial intelligence is not novel by any means. Let's turn back to 1950s or so, and in 60s, Department of Defense start to mimic human reasoning. In 70s, DARPA did street mapping project way, way before Google Maps and so. And 2003, DARPA introduced intelligence personal assistant. It's a system which recognizes voice. Again, long before Siri, Alexa, you name it. Why it's artificial intelligence so popular today? Two things happen. Increase volume of the data, and this is what machine learning need. A lot of data to build models, and improves in computer power. Right now, smartphone, iPhone, you name it, it's a like Cray computer 1990, most powerful computer in the world from 1990s. But interesting, just 3 months ago, systematic review was published and showed no performance benefit of machine learning over logistic regression for clinical prediction models. Oops. Yeah, and now I tell you why it's happened. And there are a couple limitations which artificial intelligence have. The principal limitation, what all the system they learn from the data. And there are no other way how knowledge would be incorporated in the systems. And that means any inaccuracy in the data will reflect in the results. Any additional layer of the prediction analysis have to be added separately. Another limitation, what today's systems, they train to do clearly defined task. The system which play poker cannot play solitaire or chess. The system that detect fraud cannot drive car or give you legal advice. In fact, the system detect healthcare fraud cannot accurately detect tax fraud or warranty claim fraud. And everything what we see in a movie still, science fiction. There are systems can do very simple one task. The another limitation of, and that's a really healthcare specific, EMR data has pretest probability. We all try to mine EMR data, but what happened, all patients, they have this target disorder before diagnostic test result in no. What data present in EMR, it's presented there because somebody want this data. For example, you order diagnostic troponin test because you suspect myocardial infarction. And that happens situation when EMR data have all this data which already have some pretest probability or so. Then on the top of this, any system which says something, it's already get like prediction of something what's suspected by human. Another big problem, data mining does not infer causality. See, there are perfect correlations, 0.99. U.S. spending on the science, space, and technology correlate with suicide by hanging, strangulation, and suffocation. Perfect correlation, 0.99. But really, there are no causality between these two data set. And that's a huge problem. Another problem is the data quality, because first, there are a lot missing data. When we work with data miners, they told, oh, data is not good. Okay, welcome to real world. That's the data what you experience, and even it would be worse because we massage and curate it for you. And the problem is there are a lot missing data. Another point is a data delayed in EMR. Something what people call real time, it's really not real time. Even monitor data need to be validated by the NURS and then appear in EMR, which would be mined or so. Of course, there are different stories when we have this system embedded in a hardware, but on the software or EMR, there are significant delay with any data what would be. A lot what happened on the ICD-9 codes and definition based on these codes for billing, not for quality, doesn't work very well. What would work? We all recognize these problems and try to get something which would work in clinical environment. We never have 100% accurate prediction model. And all publications can say, okay, there are like 0.85 area under curve. How good it is, Do you want to be like part of this missing patient or so? I mean, we really want to target 100% accuracy, talking about this aircraft industry, which very accurate and precise. But reality is no diagnostic test could be 100% accurate. And one of the way how to deal with this, have middle body person who would filter this information before that information would be presented to the human. For many years in the United States, exists system in major cities. The system detects gunshots, and there are a number of the microphones sitting on the poles in downtown areas. Again, that's in most of the major cities. And actually, these mics, they are listening. And when they detect something what like consider as a gunshot, they actually send this information to one single operation center where trained person listen this and try to recognize is it real gunshot or not. When they consider something as a gunshot, then they dispatch police in precise location because they have triangulation and that's a very precise. I mean, the person who filter information, it's a way to go in the near future. And control clinical control tower, it's a, something what would be used as a prediction hub for systems. The data is compiled from the pool from the core EMRs, and all these algorithms, they apply on the level of the surveillance level. Then information present to control tower operator. He actually have link back to the location, video link, talk to people on the ground if needed, and then actually decide is this prediction actual, is it prediction false, or maybe we need to postpone and wait a little bit to have more information. This is clinical system and prototype what we currently developing on the top of the EPIC. And what it does, it's actually pull data across whole hospital, Mayo Clinic Rochester, Arizona, Florida, and healthcare system. And in this particular situation, this is little score. It's a prediction algorithm for palliative care consultation need. We scan whole hospital and see if there are patients who actually benefit from palliative care consultation. SCORE is a machine learning algorithm, and it's learned as we are talking, because really when control tower operator say it's yes or not, they leave note and have this like feedback loop for this operation. But that's a way to do to implement prediction models. How this looks, for example, this is skip 4 metric, which now it's dropped from the CMS metrics. But at that time, we had this problem. Patient who get cardiac surgery and glucose was not controlled, they not paid by CMS. We implement system which scan patients who had cardiac surgery and then monitor glucose, okay? And that, for example, see, this is time frame when which we need to control glucose, and this is time zero after surgery, and we see glucose going off the limit and insulin given, and that going back to the normal numbers, which give like nice green indicator for the patient, what patient pass this metric. But not all time that was controlled, and you really can have this real-time feedback loop when you when patient not meet this limits and these criteria. Then you can click and get actually exactly and see exactly what happened. Who was in charge of this patient? How did it happen? What is timing and all these things happen? All right, that's my last slide, and we dream all about good future. And next generation of electronic medical record would be different. That would be interoperability, functional models which can be added on the top of that. Note creation would be automated and also would combine images, text, and voice. Interaction with the EMR will use more and more speech recognition. And video recognition with mimic clinical interaction would be on the top of that, like recognition of the pain. There are systems which currently can measure precisely temperature with cameras, and so on and so on. And artificial intelligence will be center of the clinical decision support, but it's really not yet there, and so on. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Herasevich. So we have maybe 2 minutes for questions. Sir, please go ahead, identify yourself.
Aranya Bakchi, Mass General. Thank you, that was great. So AI, when we talk about AI, especially in the anesthesia community, we tend to talk about two things. One is prediction of clinical events like MIs or things. The other is research. And there's a lot of well-known people in the community who seem to believe that AI can help with paradigm shifts like sepsis or, you know. I think at this point it's essentially impossible for AI to predict something where we don't have an understanding of the principles involved. AI to generate principles out of nothing, essentially. Sepsis is a good example. Even for cancer, where Watson had a lot of very well-defined pathways and algorithms to work with, it wasn't very good at translating cancer care in the international setting. I'm curious to see what your thoughts are on the evolution of AI into predicting science and becoming, you know, helping us with our with concepts which we don't understand yet. I think it's not like
Thank you for the question. And first, it's really there a misunderstanding what is a statistical process, statistical control, and AI. I mean, a lot what we see now with prediction, it's actually statistical exercise, no more, no less, yeah. But in terms of the research and prediction, I talked recently with one startup company which tried to found very, some sense from scientific publications. And instead to do impact factor, they actually use very sophisticated model to see is this citation support this publication or actually use as evidence in background section or in concordance with that or so and so. I mean, more valuable input about publication, because we see a lot of publications which get high citation, high impact factor, but they are not advanced science. And this kind of the systems, they would be probably more and more popular to identify real soil in grains in a soil. Yeah.
Any other questions? I just want to come back to your point, which is a hugely important one, and it has to do with the interpretability of machine learning, right? So a lot of machine learning can be looked at mechanistically as just throwing a bunch of variables or features at an algorithm and then generating an output, which is like a probability of something like transition to sepsis or death. And we have no idea how that black box actually made the computation. So we don't get any insights into the disease, into the science. And that is a huge problem. And interpretability is a huge problem across the field of AI. And I think a lot of the more advanced research is actively working on that process of making it discoverable, making it essentially discovering which are the features that are important and trying to understand their biological significance. But I'm glad you bring that up. I think we have maybe like 30 seconds for another quick question.
Okay.
If not, I want to thank you.
Yeah.
And I want to tell the people at the back that there are some seats up forward if you want to come back.